This air fork is $130. You can get it on Amazon. It's got compression and rebound damping. And I've used it before. If you're 140 pounds and you ride cross-country trails, this thing is gonna be fine. But I wanna know how far we can really push this thing. Recently, we went to Cane Creek's R&D lab and they had a purpose-made fork smasher. It allows them to raise a big weight over the fork and smash it exactly the same each time and get a reading. And that's what I wanna make today. I know, not the most impressive technical drawing, but it gets the point across. So here we have a heavy platform. It has to be heavy for the sake of being heavy because we're gonna use it for smashing. Then we have these clamps that we can use to hold a fork or other bike part in place. And so they're gonna need to be mounted to the platform. Then we need some sort of smasher, a big weight that can drop from the same height every single time to smash said bike part. And then here you can see in this particular case, we will install our fork in it directly below the smasher. I have to build a platform heavy enough to mount this thing to. So we're gonna build the base and frame out of wood because that's what I know how to work with and that's what I have. But we're gonna fill it with concrete and then drill holes all the way through the concrete to bolt everything to it. So this is the basin that we're gonna fill with concrete, but it's also gonna have a lot of things attached to it. And so the framing that's gonna hold our smasher, I wanna build into it first so we can also encase that in concrete. It's not gonna be very serviceable, but not gonna be expensive either. So the concrete set up overnight, if I was worried at all about the structural integrity, I wouldn't even be touching it right now. It's just there for dead weight and to fill space. In fact, you can see that the concrete doesn't quite make it to the top of the box, and so I'm gonna fill in the rest with multi-purpose sand. We're gonna cap it off with some wood, and then we're gonna start mounting things to it. Sounds sketchy, but stick with me. So to make this strong enough to endure repeated smashing, we're gonna have to attach these with through bolts. So we're gonna actually clamp those vices all the way through this base so that they can hopefully deal with all the smashing. So the plan is pull this weight all the way up and use this pin to keep the paracord in place, pull the pin, and then the weight smashes our fork. Sounds great in theory, but the fork is hovering so low on the platform that it might in fact flex, hit the platform, and then come back up, and that's not what we want. We want to give it enough room to fully bend. And so I'm gonna have to raise these vices up to make ends meet. Also, the reality of this big, round, 25-pound weight just free-falling, it's not good. I don't wanna have to do drywall work, and so we're gonna have to build some kind of enclosure to keep it in place once it bounces off the fork. Those are my main concerns, and I think they're all solvable. So it's not quite quite the moment of truth, but we're gonna see if the release mechanism works. We pull this pin out, and then hopefully this knot will go through the lower pulley, the weight will fall down and just smash into our platform and not break it. Hopefully this all doesn't get destroyed. I didn't consider that the split ring would just split. Oh yeah! Smear! So this machine just needs some finishing touches. It needs branding, warning labels. And because it is for smashing stuff, it's called the Berm Peak Smeasher. So the Berm Peak Smeasher is complete, and I've got this $130 fork you saw at the beginning of the video. Actually, I've got two of them because one of them is gonna go on a bike and we're gonna test it on the trail. But first, we're going to tear one down, see what it's made of, and then put it in the smasher and make sure the steerer tube is up to the task. So let's put this on the stand, drop the lowers, and see what's inside of it. Nothing amazingly crappy yet. They've got like a transmission fluid or something in there. So on the air spring side, there's a spring and there's a bunch of heavy red oil. It honestly doesn't look like very much could go wrong. So far I see like three different types of lubricant on this fork, which is a good sign because they decided where each of them were gonna go. My suspicions have been confirmed. The chintziest part of this fork is without question the damper. The rest of it, it's really not that bad, and if it proves to be durable, this is pretty freaking impressive for $130, and so let's put this back together and bring it to the smasher. So we've gone ahead and taken this 29-inch Suntour fork off the Kent Trouvaille. There's a pretty big disparity in weight between these. Our $130 Amazon Air fork is 2.5 pounds lighter than the fork that came on the Kent Trouvaille. And this fork regularly comes on $1,000 bikes. And we also know that these Suntour forks are pretty damn safe because they start to bend before they snap. The Suntour fork has a steel steerer tube, and the Bologna fork has an aluminum steerer tube. So we are going to rig this Suntour fork up into the smasher, give it a smash, and then see how our Amazon fork compares. First, we're gonna get the fork completely level. Then we're gonna measure how high the fork is sitting off of the mat so that we can take another measurement after the smash and see what the permanent deformity is. And now we smash it. All right. So move this destructo ball. Suntour test number one, permanent deformity of 6 millimeters. Let's run it again. So three runs through the Berm Peak Smeasher, that Suntour fork deformed 12 millimeters. Kinda hurts, but we're still gonna put bikes back on the trail, and hopefully with this data, we can find the fork that's best because we're gonna put this Bologna fork in here and see how it fares against a tried and true cheap coil fork. So before we do the test, I should say this is not an apples to apples comparison, the bologna fork is longer, it has more travel, and so there's more leverage. Yet, we don't care about those technicalities, we care how it performs at a front impact, and so let's give her a run.
Test two.
It's fair to say that the Berm Peak Smeasher needs some modifications. For one, this warning sticker has two R's in the word harm. That's a typo. And we can modify it to give us more consistent results. But with that said, we were able to run the same test on two suspension forks and get similar results. I think the only thing left to do is install.
So I had filmed a closing right then and there with my conclusions, but now that I'm looking at the footage in slow motion like you just did, I notice all the obvious problems here. First of all, the fork deflects the weight when it hits, but that's, to me, not the biggest problem. The biggest problem is that it flexes and hits into the smasher. There's a limiting factor to how much it can bend. And the result was that both forks performed very similarly. Now, it could be that they're close to the same strength and that's why they perform similarly, but more likely the platform of the smasher just limited how much they could bend. Now, although our data is wrought with problems, we know more about this fork than we did before, and so I'm definitely gonna put it on the Kent Trouvaille and give it a proper trail test, but not before I make some additional modifications to the smasher. Both of these suspension forks can bend way more before they break. And so on our second channel, Berm Peak Express, we will improve the smasher, run the test again, and then take this fork for a real trail test. I hope you learned something today. I certainly did. And if not, I hope you at least found this video entertaining. Thanks for riding with me today, and I'll see you next time.